Hey there, Nation. Welcome to the show where we help you to play miniatures wargaming on a budget. It is I, Commander Cheapskate, and today is another edition of Warhammer the Golden Age. This one is Battle Report number 23. It is a 2,000 point battle that is fought between myself with my House Daechir, the Golden Reavers of Skyros, my Dark Elves army, versus my buddy King Khalifa of the Schwartzwald Free Companies, which is the Empire army. And this battle is actually kind of interesting because the Schwartzwald Free Companies, that was a battle list that I created for my Empire army for 2,000 points up to 3,000 points. If you look back at some of my earlier videos, I did about a year ago, I did a series of videos with that Empire army, and I played in those a while since I played that. My buddy King Khalifa want to bring those guys out, want to dust them off, try them again for my Warhammer the Golden Age battle reports. So it's kind of neat. I get to see what happens when I go up against an army list that I created. So let's see what happens when 2,000 points of Dark Elves and 2,000 points of Empire clash it out on the battlefield of the Old World. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, let's go run down my list for my House Daechir, the Golden Reavers of Skyros. It is a 2,000 point Dark Elves army. For my Lords and Heroes choices, we have Beast Lord Midas Daechir and Kalibos, the Golden Lord of Skyros. He is a High Beast Master with the Chill Blade as well as the Armor of Destiny. His Manticore's name is Kalibos, and he's packing Blind Rage as well as Iron Hard Skin upgrades. Next comes Sister Sinner, the Oracle of Kosh. She's my Supreme Sorceress, level 4 upgrade. She's packing the Sacrificial Dagger as well as the Talisman of Endurance for a magic item. She's also using the Lord of Dark Magic, and the spells she rolled for this one are Power of Darkness, Blade Wind, Shroud of Despair, as well as Arinzapal's Black Horror, which is a pretty awesome spell on that port. Next we have Captain Lodi Daechir, the Golden Sun. He is a Master with a Battle Standard Bear upgrade. He's equipped with Halberd Heavy Armor, Sea Dragon Cloak and Shield, and he's got the Crown of Command. For my core choices, we have the Seastone Staros, which are 38 Dread Spears with full command and standard discipline. And after that, my second core choice is the Morning Dawn, which is 10 Dark Shards with a Standard Bearer, and they're packing the Banner of Eternal Flame. For my special choices, we have the Storms of Kos, which are 2 Reaper Bolt Throwers, and Virzil the Broken, my War Hydra, who's equipped with Fire Breath, and I gotta tell you, I just love that freaking thing. For my rare choices, we have two of them. We have the Shacklemore Seers, my 5 Doom 4 Hour Warlocks. Spells of the Cursed Coven are Doom Bolt from the Lord of Dark Magic, as well as Soul Blight from the Lord of Death. And then finally, we have Wrathric the Maw, which is my Charybdis. And that brings up my 2,000 point army for this one. Alright, let's talk about my opponent's army. This is King Khalifa's, the Schwartzwald Free Companies. It is a 2,000 point Empire army, and it's kind of interesting because it's an army I made a couple of last year for my series of battle reports. For his Lord and Hero choices, he has Archlector Gregor von Konnismark the Grim. He is an Archlector with a great weapon. He's also equipped with the Armor of Meteoric Iron. Next, we have Victor Hellsbrand of the Wilds. He's a Battle Wizard Lord. He has, for level 4 upgrade, the Book of Asher, as well as the Lore of Life, and for his spells, he rolled up Earthblood, Throne of Vines, Flesh to Stone, as well as the Dweller's Below, so a pretty deadly combination there. Next comes Hauptmann Dieter Moons, the Griffin Guard. He is a captain who is a Battle Standard Bear upgrade. He's equipped with Plate Armor, Shield, as well as Great Weapon, and he's carrying the Griffin Banner. Next comes Hauptmann Hans Jaeger and Konigswinter. He's equipped with Full Plate Armor, Sword of Might, and Charm Shield, and he also is riding Konigswinter, which is a Pegasus. And his final hero is Maximilian the Max. He is a Battle Wizard level 2 upgrade. He's equipped with a Dispel Scroll. He also is carrying the Lore of Metal, and he's carrying Searing Doom, as well as Enchanted Blades of Ibon as his two spells. For his core choice, he has the Yellow Company, which is a massively huge unit of 38 halberdiers with full command, and he also has two detachments. Both of them are 20 halberdiers. He has the Red Company as well as the Blue Company, so that's a huge block of infantry I gotta deal with. Next, he has Rommel's Rangers, which are 10 archers, who also have two units of 5 archers as detachments, as well as the Kreen Rangers, which are 10 archers as well. For his special choices, he has Donner, the Great Cannon, and for his rare choices, he has Blitzen, the Hellblaster Volley Gun, and the one, the only, the Panzer Baron, the steam tank. And I remember using that guy to steamroll right over my opponents, so it's gonna be kind of interesting to see how I go up against this army. So that brings up King Khalifa's 2,000 points on this one. Let's move on to deployment.
Assemble the army!
Alright, with the armies assembled, let's go ahead and talk about deployment real quick. And if you also notice in the background, you can hear kind of music going on. That's actually some background music I decided to try adding to these battle reports and, try to jazz them up a little, so make them slow and a little bit more interesting. Anyways, let's go ahead and talk about deployment real quick. All right, so we're fighting on our typical 4x6 table. As you can see, my opponent, King Khalifa, has set up his Empire army on the near side of the board, right between the hill, as well as that massively huge farming complex, which is then the left-hand side of the battlefield for his side. And I'm going to play on the very far side of the battlefield, so I'm actually fighting on a side of the field I'm usually not used to fighting on. But regardless, as you can see there, we have a lot of terrain pieces set up. We have a farming complex on the left-hand side that makes up his protects his left-hand flank. He's got a hill on the right-hand flank. We got a chateau there in the center of the board, as well as a stack of ruins. We have some forests. Also in the very bark left-hand corner on the far side of the board, we have some hills, as well as a little hut with a little pig herd, which we'll talk a pig pen, which we'll look at here in a second. And we also kind of off-frame, we have a tower on the right-hand corner. So let's go down to the individual deployment zones and talk about what happened there. Alright, so let's go ahead and talk about my left flank for my army. As you can see, located on the very far left-hand side, I have three of my monsters. I have Heroes of the Broken, my War Hydra, then the left-hand side. In the center, I have Wrathric the Maw, as well as on the right-hand side, I have Beast Lord Midas Daechir, the Golden Lord of Skyros, and on his Manticore Kalibos. And for these guys, their position is actually kind of really simple. I'm going to have them try to march up as quickly as they can on that left-hand flank, try to charge my opponent on the left-hand side. I'm not sure what I'm going to do because directly across from me, we also have my opponent's steam tank, so I'm just going to try to leapfrog these three units across the battlefield as quickly as possible, have them take some cover, and then engage my enemy in the left-hand flank and just kind of sweep across his main battle line. So that's the scheme on this side of my deployment. Alright, let's talk about my center deployment. Starting from the left and moving right, we have the Morning Dawn, which is my 10 Dark Shards. Those guys are equipped with repeater crossbows. They also have the Banner of Flame, so that way if my opponent has any, well, he doesn't really have any cavalry, but I have those, basically have them equipped with that, so that way they can shoot at any units or, and try to cause flaming attacks if at all possible. On the right-hand side of them, I have my Seastone Sorrows. That is my massively huge unit of 38 Dread Spears. They're also equipped with the Standard Bearer, as well as the Standard Discipline that gives them the plus-up leadership. Also in that unit on the left-hand side of the front rank, I have my Supreme Sorceress Sister Sinner, the Oracle of Kos, and also on the right-hand flank, I have my Battle Standard Bearer, Captain Lodi Daechir. And the reason why they're located in that unit as well is that Lodi Daechir has a Crown of Command, makes them stubborn at Leadership 10, so they're not going to be fleeing or breaking at all. At the same time, I also have plenty of people for my sorceress to kill if she needs to use a Sacrificial Dagger as well to kind of boost her spells. So that makes deployment here in the center lines. And here's a picture of my right-hand flank. Unfortunately, I forgot to take a picture of my very far right flank. Actually, to the right of this frame, there is a tower that is in the right-hand corner of my deployment area. And on that one, I have my two Storms of Kos, which are my two Reaper Bolt Throwers. That way, they have a kind of good, like, inflating fire all the way down the lines of my opponents so they can just kind of pick their targets on that location. Right here in the center of the picture, however, I have my five Doomfire Warlocks, my Shacklemore Seers. And basically, the idea for my deployment is to have my Seastone Sorrows, as well as my Morning Dawn, kind of move up slowly and cautiously down the middle of the board and kind of set themselves up for a good position to receive any charges that my opponent might send my way. I'm also planning on sending my Doomfire Warlocks, my Shacklemore Seers, to just go flying across the right-hand flank and try to engage his War Machines on the hill that are located across from me, try to take them out as well. And of course, with my two Storms of Kos, which are off the screen on this point, they're on the tower, there's going to be inflating fire. My very first priority, however, is that steam tank, because my opponent receives no armor saves if I shoot at them with the main bolt from those two bolt throwers. So I plan on taking out that steam tank and then just taking apart his infantry units bit by bit using my monsters as well as my forces. So that's pretty much the plan, how I'm planning on going for this battle. Alright, so this is the Empire's left flank. As you can see in this picture, the only thing that's holding down his entire left-hand side is the Panzer Bear and his steam tank. And it kind of makes sense as well, because if you look there on the left-hand side, he has a series of fields located there, as well as that granary silo right there as well. So his left flank is pretty much secure, because that terrain would be kind of dangerous for anything to kind of go through there. So that makes up his left-hand flank for this one. And for his center line, which is that huge block of awesomeness that I'm going to have to face, starting from the left-hand side and from the front working back, well, you can see that we have that huge line of skirmishing archers. Those guys are Rommel's Rangers. We have the 10 archers in the center right before that huge horde of halberdiers right in front of them, right behind them. And then you have, of course, two 5-man detachments on either side covering the flanks. Right behind the left-hand side of a set of archers, we have the Blue Company. Those are 20 halberdiers, no shields, no commands, because they're a detachment unit. Right next to them on the right-hand side, we have the yellow company that has a huge horde of halberdiers. There's 37 of those guys. Included that unit as well, we have Maximilian Max, which is the level 2 wizard who's using the Lord of Metal. We also have his Archlector Gregor von Konigsmark the Grim, who's his general. He also has his Battle Standard Bearer Hauptmann Dieter Moons, who's Carol Supreme the Griffin Banner. And that's actually kind of a really deadly magical item used for those guys, because that magical item actually doubles up his rank bonuses as well. So I'm going to have to deal with that pretty soon, and that's going to be really difficult to kind of crack those guys. Right behind the yellow company, of course, we have the Queen's Rangers, another unit of 10 archers. Those are handgunners, but we're using those to proxy. The 10 archers are supposed to be back there. And to the left, right next to them, right behind the unit of the yellow yellow company, is Victor Hellsbear of the Wilds. That's his Lore of Life wizard that he has tucked back there and kind of protect at the same time. On the right-hand side there, we also have the Red Company. That's another unit of 20 halberdiers. And to the very far right-hand side, we have Blitzen. That is the Vihel Blaster Volley Gun. And I am absolutely terrified of that war machine. I know if I engage in close combat on the right-hand side, he's just going to open up that thing and destroy anything he can. So that pretty much makes up his center deployment for this one. And lastly, we have the right flank from my enemy's deployment area. As you can see right there in the center of the picture on top of his hill, he has Donner, that is his great cannon. It's got a kind of a good position to open a fire onto my entire line of my army so that we can just kind of pick and choose his targets. On the very far right-hand side, he has Hauptmann Hans Jaeger, as well as Konigswinter, his captain, mounted on a Pegasus. And the reason why he has those guys located there is because if you're looking for him, he has that chateau. On the other side of that chateau, you actually have my tower, or my two bolt throwers located at, and I have the sneaking suspicion that he's going to try to fly that unit as quickly as he possibly can across the battlefield and engage my bolt throwers, so that way I can't really use them for this battle. So I'm also got to deal with that problem as well. So with that being said, this makes up my enemy's deployment zones. Go to the top of turn number one. Alright, and that takes us to the top of turn number one for the Empire. We both rolled off for initiative. The Empire won on this battle report. So because of that, they were starting to move out after move phase. And as you can see in this photo, he just basically spent no time wasting any time just moving up as quick as he can to come engage me and to start, you know, making life difficult for me, for my soldiers. So starting from the left-hand side, moving all the way to the right, you know, you had the Panzer Baron. That thing moved up about 11 inches using its steam points to get there. And at the same time, he kept two more steam points in reserve so that way he can fire his main cannon as well. For the rest of his army, he marched up his entire main line. He marched up Rommel's Rangers, which is the skirmishers in the front lines. He also marched up his three units of halberdiers right behind them to add support. He also marched up Victor Hellsbrad, as well as the Queen's Rangers, to kind of lend support from behind as well. His artillery pieces stayed exactly where they're located there on the edge of the hill there. And on the right-hand side, he moved up Hans Jaeger, as well as Konigswinter, his captain on the Pegasus, into that tower area next to the chateau. And he moved his troops in such a way so that way that he is partially hidden from by the building, so my bolt throwers can't shoot at him whatsoever. So that is also kind of infuriating at that point as well. So that makes a move for this one. Here's a close-up of his movement down the left-hand flank, and you can see that his steam tank is heading straight to my monsters and starting to cause all kinds of problems. The only thing that's kind of going for me at this point is I have those forests located right there in front of me, so that way I can kind of disrupt his army as they try to move through the forest. They'll lose their ability to remain steadfast, so that's the only thing I have going for me on that portion. So I'm just kind of like worried at this huge tidal wave of humanity that's coming right at me. And here's a close-up of his right-hand flank. As you can see, there's Konigswinter as well as Hans Jaeger right in front of that chateau. And there is the tower that we're talking about. I apologize for not taking a picture of that during deployment, as well as during the entire picture of the battlefield as well. Kind of an error on my part on that side. So you can see that there's the tower there. Let's look in the right-hand corner. I got my two bolt doors, my Storms of Kos located there at the top, so that way I can put down some infilling fire. And as you can also see, his Pegasus is kind of hidden by the building, so I really can't shoot at it with my bolt doors. So that's kind of rough there. So I'm going to figure out something to do, some way to deal with that. During the magic phase, he managed to get off the spell Throne of Vines for his life mage there in the back, so that caused all kinds of problems for me, because now he has a bunch of abilities that I added to his spells and make them kind of stronger. I did try to throw a couple of my dispel dice at it. However, I was just rolling terribly for my dispel rolls. I was rolling like a bunch of ones as well as a bunch of twos. It's just been happening to me these last few days where I've just been kind of rolling like horribly for each of my battle reports. So because of that, he got the Throne of Vines off as well. He also gave up a 4-up regen for his Earthblood spell onto his unit of halberdiers to kind of protect them as well. So everything else I managed to stop, but those two spells are the ones I managed to get through, so that was kind of depressing. So with magic done, we go directly on to the shooting phase. During the shooting phase, all 20 of his archers for his front line of skirmishers try to open up onto my unit of dread spears, my Seastone Staros. I got lucky on that part. He only got two of my guys off. He was firing at long range. He was moving, and he also was firing at the long range as well. So because they had to roll like sixes in order to get me, so I was really, really lucky on that part. He was out of range with his other unit of Queen's Rangers because they're behind the Halberdiers, so it couldn't do much to me with those guys. So, you know, two Dark Elves. I'll take it.
This is my boomstick!
Alright, during this portion of the shooting phase, my opponent takes a steam tank Panzer Baron and opens up with that steam tank's great cannon directly at Virus of the Broken Land. That shot perfectly managed to inflict three wounds on my poor War Hydra. So right off the bat, my War Hydra is now down half wounds, and I just know he's planning on using Donner, which is his next great cannon, just to inflict the wounds onto poor Virus of the Broken. So I'm just praying to the gods right now that my War Hydra somehow managed to survive all this. The wonderful long-range shooting of the Empire continues onward when Blitzen, the Hellblaster Volley Gun, opens up. He's within perfectly 24 inches of my Doomfire Warlocks. He takes that bad boy, opens up, he gets 15 shots off. He manages to kill two of my Doomfire Warlocks at the same time, so two of my Shacklemore Seers are now dead. And while this shooting was taking place, I'm just thinking in the back of my head, this is what it must have felt like. This is what my opponents must have felt like when they were fighting against me when I was playing this army. And it just felt like a lot of karma was coming my way. So this is the second time that's happened to me, because I fought against my opponent, smells like Febreze, with my Sylvaneth army, and I got to feel what that was like. And now I'm starting to feel exactly the same thing with my Dark Elves army now in Warhammer, the 8th edition. So I'm starting to think now that I'm starting to understand how my opponents must have felt every single time I fought them with those armies. However, the Dark Gods must have been listening to my vagrant prayers I was kind of shouting out to the heavens to make the shooting stop. So I got pretty lucky on that part. My opponent, King Khalifa, rolled to fire with his Great Cannon in order to get it balanced. He's going to try to shoot at Veers of the Broken again and try to finish off my War Hydra with another cannon shot. But he rolled a misfire on that part. And he rolled, I think, a 3 or a 4. That's the one where the cannon is out of commission for this turn as well as his next turn as well. So while it's kind of rough for my Empire buddy, my friend King Khalifa, to have his cannon out for two turns, it's kind of a blessing for me, because now I don't have to worry about that thing too much. So yeah, I guess the Dark Gods do listen once in a while. Your prayers are always answered, just in the order that they're received, I guess. Alright, because since none of the Empire players are engaged in close combat, we're now at the bottom of turn number 1 after Moon for the Dark Elves, and as you see in this photo, I just start sending all my troops moving as quickly as I possibly can. I really need to get out of range of those long-range firepower for my monsters and get those guys engaged in close combat as quickly as possible, so that way they don't get shot to pieces by artillery fire. At the same time, I also need to move up my main line of my army, so that way my opponent can move up to me and start kind of getting his guys out of position, so that way I can start flanking with my monsters and kind of taking care of that situation. Also, on the right-hand side there, you can see I also marched up my Doomfire Warlocks away from the hut straight towards my opponent King, straight toward my opponent's captain on his Pegasus, so that way they can Doombolt that guy out of existence, because I really need my Bolt Throwers to survive for this battle. So that pretty much makes up the kind of like the movement that I had going on for my army. Here's a close-up of my steam tank, and pretty much the idea is I'm planning on using my monsters to kind of charge that thing and just kind of get rid of it real quick. The idea, I'm not sure I'm going to send in either Veers of the Broken or Wrathrith the Maw or my Manticore. Basically, I'm just trying to move up as quickly as possible, just started moving up there. What I should have done, looking back now, I should have marched those guys forward, but I just only moved them just kind of like a little bit, made a move up the usual movement distance, because my idea was I didn't want to get countercharged by that steam tank and get destroyed, so I just wanted to keep some distance. At the same time, looking back now, that probably wasn't such a smart idea, because they could still shoot at me. I gave my opponent another turn to shoot at me, but, you know, hindsight's 2020, I guess. So the idea is I'm going to send these monsters flying into through that steam tank. The idea is I'm going to try to move past that steam tank, attack my enemy's Red Company, which is the left-hand side, which is his unit of 20 Halberdiers, because those guys would be easy to kill with my monsters. And then from there, just sweep across his main line and just kind of destroy him that way. And here's a close-up of my center lines. As you can see, I kept the Morning Dawn back to kind of keep him reserved so that they can shoot anything that comes moving up forward. I also moved my my Dread Spears, my Seastone Staros. I only move up their regular movement distance of 5 inches to kind of get them set up. My idea is to have my opponent go through the forests. I might be able to shoot them, might be able to engage within the forest that way, so that way they're in the middle of the forest. They have no rank bonus. They have no, they're disruptive, so they have no leadership bonuses for ranks when it comes to their break tests. That's pretty much the idea that I want to come up with that in order to affect their leadership on that side. So that's what I'm kind of shooting for here in the center portion of my army. And here's a close with my Doomfire Warlocks. So they're planning on Doom bolting that that Pegasus Rider. Yeah, Doom. So I'm starting to sound like Invader Zim. Doomfire Warlocks firing Doom up on my Doom enemies' heads. So I plan on firing Doom Bolt, get that guy, destroy that guy, so that way my bolt doors are completely free and clear. And at that same time, I can start laying in some long distance firepower with my Doom Bolt, with my bolt doors against that steam tank and getting that thing out of the way. So that makes a move for this right hand side. During the magic phase, I managed to get off Arenzapal's Black Horde. I originally tried to use Doombolt and try to destroy that Pegasus Rider, but unfortunately for me, my opponent dispelled that spell, so he used a Dispel Scroll to get rid of that one, so I couldn't really destroy his opponent. My opponent's Imperial Cavalry Rider for his Pegasus Knight. However, I did manage to get, like I said before, Arenzapal's Black Horde off. It kind of swept through the entire main line. I managed to kill 4 from the Blue Company, 3 from the Yellow Company, and 2 from the, whatchamacallit, from the, 4 from the Red Company on the left-hand side, 3 from the Yellow Company in the center, 1 from the Queen's Rangers there in the back, as well as managed to kill 2 more of the Blue Company there on the right-hand flank. And the reason why is because my opponent was just rolling perfectly for his strength test. He was rolling a bunch of 1s, a bunch of 2s, and a bunch of 3s, not many more 4s or higher. And usually it's the other way around. Usually, if you have low strength, it's really hard to save your guys. Or if you have high strength characters, they kind of survive it. But my buddy King Khalifa just kind of proved that theory wrong. So most of his guys are still alive. So I was kind of sad about that part. During the shooting phase, I also brought the pain as well. Luckily for me, both of my Reaper Bolt Throwers from my Storms of Cost managed to land a single shot, the massive bolt, onto that steam tank. However, when it came to the damage roll, I didn't do very good. I only managed to flink off 3 wounds off that steam tank. However, that is 3 wounds more than that thing was originally carrying. And plus, when you put in conjecture with in combination with generating steam points, it could be enough to kind of drop that guy as well. So I'm going to count my blessings and kind of take him as I get him. So luckily for me, though, that thing has no armor save whenever I fire my main bolts, because bolt throwers have no armor saves. So I'm going to try to finish that guy off in the next round, have my monsters kind of swarm that guy, and kind of just kind of deal with him that way. So that makes up the shooting phase on this side of the board. And since there's no close combat, we go to the end of my turn, and I use my Hydra's regeneration ability. I only managed to heal 1 wound on that guy, but then again, that's 1 less wound he has to worry about for the end of this round. So that was kind of like a little nice consolation prize there at the end. So with my turn over, we go directly to the top of turn number 2 for the Empire. Alright, so this is the top of turn number 2 after moving phase for the Empire, and as you can see in this photo, he just doesn't waste any time. King Khalifa starts moving up his forces as quickly as possible. In fact, on his flanks on the left-hand side, the Panzer Baron manages to charge into my War Hydra, so Fears of the Broken's got to deal with that thing by himself. At the same time, I also have to worry about Hans Jaeger Konigswinter, his Imperial Captain on a Pegasus. He managed to charge directly into my Repeat Ray Reaper Bolt Throwers as well, so my Storms of Cost are now engaged with that. He also marches up his skirmishers from Rommel's Rangers, marches them right through the forest on the other side to get ready to engage my Dread Spears. At the same time, he just kind of moves up his normal infantry, their normal 5 inches, to kind of lend support there in the center portion. So yeah, that makes it the movement for his turn. Here is a close-up of Panzer Baron moving into where my Fears of the Broken is located at. He used 2 steam points in order to engage him in close combat that way. That's also going to add 2d3 impact hits, which is already d6 impact hits that steam tank gets. He also has two more steam points left over that he can use for his steam gun too. And he uses kind of like a breath weapon in close combat, so that's going to be kind of rough. So I'm not really thinking that Fears of the Broken is going to survive this combat, unfortunately. Alright, here's a close-up of his center lines as well. As you can see from the back ranks moving up forward, he has his Queen's Rangers as well as his Wizard, Victor Housebred of the Wilds, kind of take up the rear there. He also has his Red Company on the left-hand side, as well as his Blue Company on the right-hand side, as well as the Yellow Company right there in the center. And he just moved up those units just up their normal 4 inches, regular movement to get them to the other side of that force. At the same time, however, he did march up his entire unit of skirmishers up to through the forest and to the other side of the forest there in order to gauge my Dread Spears as well. I forgot to mention this in the previous turn during the shooting phase. I forgot to take a photo of it, but the left-hand unit of 5 skirmishers that are supposed to be there in front of the Red Company, those guys actually got shot up on my Morning Dawn. I forgot to mention that last turn. I apologize for that. So, yeah, that makes up his movement here in the center. And here's a close-up of the charge that took place here on the right-hand side with Hauptmann Hans Jaeger as well as Konigswinter. He managed to charge up from directly from the bottom of that chateau to the top of the tower, and now he's engaged with my Storms of Kos. So now my bolt throwers are out of commission at this point because they're too busy trying to fight to stay alive. So with that being said, we move on to the magic phase, return number 2 for the Empire. So during the magic phase, my buddy King Khalifa rolls up to see how many dice he gets for his ability to for his dice pool to cast spells. He only gets 4 dice, so I figure he's gonna try to, you know, redo Earthblood, try to give some buffs for his troop, and he decides, nope, I'm gonna go for Dwellers for Below and throws all 4 dice. I think I rolled like a 3 and a 2. There was no way I was stopping that spell from going off. And just like that, my poor unit of spearmen, my Seastone Stars, those guys get literally cut in half. Half of their friends are dead now because of those freaking strength tests. So when it comes to my opponent, he's gotta take strength tests. He managed to roll a bunch of 1s, 2s, and 3s and survives. When I roll a strength test, I roll nothing but 4s, 5s, and 6s basically. So half of those guys are now dead. They got dragged down to their deaths, to their doom. Luckily for me, my Supreme Sources, as well as my captain, my master Captain Lodi Daechir, they both managed to survive. And man, oh god, absolutely brutal magic phase. Absolutely brutal. It was just ridiculous. And to add insult to injury, during the shooting phase, his skirmishers opened up on my unit of Dread Spears and had to kill 2 more of my CSO Staros, so that was pretty sad too. So now I have 2 of my guys now dead. So yeah, absolutely wonderful at this part. I had this huge, huge phalanx of troops that are down to half strength now. Almost down to half strength now, so oof, just absolutely brutal. And at the same time, for my Doomfire Warlocks, I thought I had positioned them in such a way that they'd actually not receive any fire at all from the Hellblaster Volleygun. I thought that wall would basically protect them. I was wrong. My assumptions were absolutely wrong on that part. When my buddy drew a straight line directly from his Hellblaster Volleygun to my Doomfire Warlocks, he just cut loose with that bad boy and started, you know, just going to town on those poor guys. He managed to roll 10 shots, but however, one of his dice was a misfire, so only 5 shots were actually rolled on that part. So I got really lucky on that part. I also lost one of my Doomfire Warlocks as well, so lucky for me, my ward saves kind of went through on that part, but yeah. Dude, that Hellblaster Volleygun, I forgot how terrifying that thing can absolutely be when you have to face against it. In the close combat phase, my poor War Hydra, Veers of the Broken, didn't stand a chance at all. It was absolutely brutal on that part. Even my opponent rolled some like 9 impact hits when he went to go smash right into him when he did his charge, and those impact hits were enough to put down Veers of the Broken. So now my War Hydra is dead and is no more. Now, there is a plus side to this. Even though my War Hydra is dead from that impact hits from the steam tank, the steam tank is in a weird kind of position where it can't see my flank really well, so either one of my monsters. So this next phase, if I'm lucky enough, I can actually move my monsters out of the engagement area entirely and just, you know, skip the dealing with that steam tank altogether. However, close combat here in the tower between my Storms of Kos and Konigs and Hanzing and Konigsberger actually went pretty well. He only managed to kill one of my crewmen on my bolt thrower, so I got really lucky on that part. My opponent King Khalifa kind of flubbed his rolls on that part. Unfortunately for me though, because he's only engaged in one of my war machines right now, I only have 1 attack, didn't really go through at all whatsoever, so we're still stuck in a stalemate. However, what I'm planning on doing is taking my other 2 crewmen there on the top of the tower and having them charge directly into Konigswinter as well as Hanzing. And maybe we might be able to put that guy on the ground and just kind of kill him off, so who knows. We'll see exactly what happens on that part. So that pretty much makes a combat, and so with combat done, we go directly to the top of turn number 2 for the Dark Elves. So this is the bottom of turn number 2 for the Dark Elves after the movement phase, and as you can see in this picture, I just sent everything charging forward as quickly as possible. Starting from the left-hand side, I charged in both Lord Midas Daechir, the Golden Lord of Skyros, on his Manticore Calibos, as well as Wrathric the Maw, and charged directly into that unit of Halberdiers on the left-hand side of the Red Company. That's going to be kind of easy combat. I'm planning on hopefully destroying that entire unit in the first round of combat, overrunning past them. The idea with that is I'll take my 2 monsters, overrun, go directly, and set myself up perfectly for flank charges into the Yellow Company, or into my opponent's Wizard, or into whatever units I can possibly get into at the same time. There in the center, on the other side of the forest, I'm going to show that in the close-up, I discharge my Seastone Staros into that unit of Rommel's Rangers, just kind of get rid of those guys, and maybe overrun, and then get into the engage of the Yellow Company as well. Here's a close with my Seastone Staros engaging that unit of Rommel's Rangers. As you can see, because they're skirmishers, they get in kind of like a line formation to engage my entire unit. At the same time, because this unit also has detachment rules, that unit of 5-man detachment on the right-hand side also countercharges well and got me in the flank, so I will not be getting any rank bonuses, but that's not really going to matter really because I didn't reform because I needed to charge. So instead of reforming and taking a turn to reform and then moving my guys out, I decided to charge directly into combat because I imagined myself, my guys, going right through this unit. Once I wipe out these skirmishers, I'll do a quick combat reform afterwards to get them into like a regular confirmation, then maybe having them get ready to deal with that unit of yellow company halberdiers on the other side of that forest. So that was the idea here. The scheme here is to have those guys, my Seastone Staros, kind of acting as my anchor, so that way my flanking units can kind of sweep through the battle lines. And over here on the far right-hand side, I just marched up my Doomfire Warlocks, my Shacklemore Seers as quickly as possible. I got them in positions so that way they can kind of charge up that hill and engage the Great Cannon. Maybe, if I'm really lucky, get a spell off and destroy one of these two artillery pieces as well, because the Hellblaster Volleygun has just been playing Mary Hobb with that unit of Doomfire Warlocks this entire time, and I got to do something quick before those artillery pieces wipe out my Doomfire Warlocks. In the magic phase, it actually went pretty good for me on that part. I rolled like 6 magic dice, and one of the spells I got off first was Power of Darkness. My opponent, King Khalifa, let that spell go through because he was afraid I was going to try to use Orinzapal's Black Horror again. So because of that magic, I get 2 more magic dice added to my pool. Also gave +1 strength to my Dread Spears, which is really going to help out because I'm planning on just curb stopping these archers, get rid of them like the nuisances that they are, and then have them kind of rejoin the fight later on for the rest of my army. So that's the magic phase here in the center portion of my board. I also managed to cast Shroud of Despair as well. Now, I know I did this out of order. I should have, you know, because I charged him with my terror-causing units already, so I should have had Shroud of Despair cast off before I started charging in my units. However, at the time, I just wasn't able to get it off like I wanted to during that time period. So because of that, I did cast that spell now. What Shroud of Darkness does, it takes away any inspiring presence as well as hold your ground rules away from my opponents, so now they'll not be able to benefit from their general's leadership or from rerolls from the Battle Center Bearer as well, which is pretty good because my plan here is to start doing some massive huge combats with my monsters, tear through these infantry units, causing the break. Plus, they have a -1 to leadership and they gotta take a break test anyways, or any kind of leadership test, and that way I can kind of cause these guys a break and then pursue them and run them down. And that's exactly what my plan is for this part. So now that entire unit, whole line of everything within 12 inches, from the wizard in the back, Victor Helsbrad, to the Queen's Rangers, those purple handgunners, to the red and blue company, as well as the yellow company, this is gonna cause all kinds of psychological problems for them. And so I was really lucky when that spell got off. And just to help to kind of illustrate that point, during the shooting phase, I had my Morning Dawn. They were within direct contact. They got open fire onto that unit of the Blue Company, which is that unit of halberdiers there on the right-hand side. They opened up magic to kill 5 members of that group, so because that, I was forced to pick a panic check on that part. And without inspiring presence or hold your ground rules, plus -1 to leadership, your halberdiers are basically just fancified goblins at that point. They failed their panic check. They basically ran back 5 inches as well, so they're currently fleeing. And because they're fleeing within 12 inches of another unit, which is the Hellblaster Volleygun, they also failed their panic check as well, so they can't fire this turn either. So kind of a nice little step going up here on the right hand flank. We get able to buy some more time for my Doomfire Warlocks to kind of do their movement shenanigans and engage the Great Cannon on the top of the hill, and at the same time kind of secure the right hand flank for my army at the same time. So kudos to all on this part. During the close combat phase, my Seastone Sorrows had no problem whatsoever getting rid of Rommel's Rangers. They killed that unit of skirmishers down to the man. Mainly it was because of the +1 strength that I received from that Power of Darkness spell. Every single time I rolled a 3 to wound, I just managed to kill one of those guys because they didn't have any armor on them as well. Plus my Always Strike First, the higher initiative, plus Murderous Prowess, rerolling ones to wound. It was no problem whatsoever to get rid of that unit of skirmishers. It's pretty awesome. Afterwards, I did a quick combat reform of that unit to get them into a proper column formation because I'm going to have to deal with that unit of yellow company halberdiers here in the second. They're going to be able to fight them with some rank bonuses. The rest of the combat phase is absolutely brutal for my opponent. As you can see in this picture, both Rathrick the Maw as well as my general Beast Lord Midas Daechir managed to wipe out that unit of Red Company Halberdiers like it was nobody's business. Not only did they wipe them out, they also overran as well. So you can see in this picture, they just kind of ran right past them. I think Rathrick the Maw ran 5 inches while my general ran, I think, 9 or 10 inches. So because of their kind of setup, they did a quick combat reform, kind of set themselves in positions in order to charge into the rear as well as in the flank of the yellow company as well, and be able to engage those guys in close combat. So that's pretty much makes up my combat phase on this side of the board as well. Meanwhile, back of the tower, the combat between Hans Jaeger and Koneswinter against my first Storms of the Cost went absolutely horrible. Didn't manage to put a single wound on that guy whatsoever, so he managed to curb stomp that poor Bolthor back to his baser elements, so now that unit is now dead. He then overran to charge directly into the next war machine as well to kind of follow through the next combat, so combat is still going on for another round between the Bolthor crews as well as this captain on Pegasus. And that takes us directly to the top of turn number 3 for the Empire after the movement phase. And as you can see in this photo, this photo kind of shows you the genius of how King Khalifa kind of runs my army. So not only did I make this list for him to use from based on a list that I made a couple last year when I was using it for a couple of my battle reports, he's learned to to use the skirmishing elements of this army like it's nobody's business as well. So let's go ahead and talk about the Royal Fist. So as you can see here, right directly behind the Yellow Company, what he does is that he moves his wizard, he marches him directly out of the charge range of Wrath of the Maw, kind of cuts him there on the right-hand side between both the Blue Company as well as the Yellow Company. And then what he does is he takes the Queen's Rangers, the skirmishers of archers, and moves them up with just a couple of inches short of Wrathric the Maw as well. But the reason why I'm focusing on that is because the way he directed and moved his unit, I can't charge the rear of the Yellow Company with either with either Wrathric the Maw with my Charybdis or with my general either, because when you look at the angles of which they would charge, they would have to engage that unit of archers first and have to go through those guys and then charge into the back rank of the Yellow Company. This in turn gives the Yellow Company some time in order to get out of the way, to move some things out of the way, and then have to force me to redirect with some of my charges or move in charges to different items as well, so that it kind of saves his main body at the same time. As you can see, it's a beautiful, brilliant use of using his skirmishers in order to do that. So my buddy King Khalif is a genius at that way. Same thing with how he delayed my spearmen using his skirmishers in the front of his army as well. So he did that to kind of like stop me from exploding and completely surrounding his forces at the same time. As that is happening, on the left-hand side, the steam tank, the Panzer Baron, uses steam points to turn around and kind of move back to the main lines in order to fight both my monsters to kind of gauge them as well. Also on the far right-hand side as well, his Blue Company also rallies, so that way they turn around and they start marching forward again as well. And at the same time, his sally for him, Blitzen, his Hellblaster Volley Cannon, fails his leadership test and it still can't fire because the crew members are still panicking on that part. So yeah, that pretty much makes it the move phase for this one for the Empire. King Khalifa's luck during the magic phase wasn't really with him. He didn't roll very many dice to begin with, and most of the spells I managed to dispel were pretty easy for me. He tried to get off Dolores from below, so I got rid of that spell so that way he couldn't cast. However, what he was reserving his spell for was for his Flesh to Stone spell. He cast that spell onto his skirmishers as well as giving them a 4-up toughness rating. So because of that, now those guys are toughness 7, which means that Wrath of the Maw had to roll a 4 or higher in order to wound these guys in close combat if I decided to engage with them during my next phase. So just like once again, showing the genius of King Khalifa, buffing up those archers to keep me from engaging his guys from the rear in order to take them out and game in a pincer attack. The guy's just really good. He's just too good. He's a really good tactician, really good general, and knows how to use his army. So good job to my opponent on that part. And then the shooting phase happens, and oh my god, the shooting phase, it was just absolutely ridiculous. He fires the cannon from both the Panzer Baron, his steam tank, as well as from Donner, his great cannon from on top of the hill. They both manage to shoot, both manage to wound, and they both manage to kill Wrathric the Maw right in front of me. Luckily for me, my general passes panic test because he just saw that guy get curb stomped by cannonballs flying both ways, and so that was absolutely rough. Looking back now, like I said before, I should have engaged that steam tank with my general because my general has the Chill Blade, and the Chill Blade's ability is that it automatically wounds. All I have to do is just roll to hit. And since my general has such a high weapon skill, and he has Always Strikes First, and he also has Murderous Prowess as well, he would automatically just start issuing out 3 wounds per turn on that steam tank and manage to take him out. Plus, Calibos's Mana Corporea has a pretty high strength, plus with Blind Rage and my D3 ability, for extra attack ability for my general, it would be able to take out that steam tank. Because I didn't do that, because I didn't engage that steam tank, the steam tank was there to add the additional firepower needed to take out my Charybdis as well. So now my plans of engaging these units from behind and getting into a pincer attack is looking less and less likely because my spearman unit has dropped down considerably in size. I don't have both my monsters to kind of get this off, so I'm not sure exactly what's going to happen. I'm just scrambling for good ideas at this point. And then again, once again, the close combat here in the tower with my bolt throwers was completely atrocious. I flubbed all my rolls, did not manage to wound Hans Jaeger or Königswinter at least once at all, and he managed to curb stop my guys with that sort of might ability. However, there was kind of a plus that came out of this. What happened was because this guy is equipped with the charm shield that gives him a plus up 2 ward save against from this first hit that's directed against him. That charm shield was originally set up in case if any of my artillery pieces managed to hit this guy, and that's originally the way that it was designed to do that, so that way they can ignore the first artillery strike against them and then continue on moving and then engage in close combat. So now he lost his 2 ward saves, and the only thing he has going for him now is his plate armor, his shield, as well as his mounted save, which gives him an armor rating of 3 up, which is not as good as having any ward saves or anything like that. So because of that, I have made him vulnerable for long range fire. So that's the flip side, and that's the positive at that. At least that's what I'm telling myself in order to keep from despairing at this point. So with combat over, we go directly to the top of turn number three, bottom of turn number three, rather, after movement. As you can see in this picture, there has been some movement from my army, starting from the back and moving forward to the left-hand side. I decided to move up my Morning Dawn and move them up there. They're just their normal 5 inches, so that way they can shoot during the shooting phase. Granted, they'll lose a minus one to their hit, but, you know, that's just the risk I'm going to have to run at this point, because I have really nothing else going on for me. The rest of my army also charges in, is what happens. So as you can see in the middle of the page there, I charge in my Seastone Sorrows. They go directly to the front of that unit of the yellow company. As well, I also bypass those skirmishers with my general, Beast Lord Midas Daechir and Calibos. I kind of skirt past them and charge directly to their wizard, who's kind of by himself there. Decided to get rid of that guy because that guy's been causing all kinds of problems for me. And also on the right-hand side there, I also charge in my Doomfire Warlocks, my Shacklemore Seers, into Dawn of the Cannon and try to get some revenge for it, killing Wrathric the Maw. Alright, so here is a close-up of the center lines. As you can see there, I have my spearmen kind of engaged and halberdiers there in the front. My plan is to keep that unit engaged as long as possible, while my general, which is located in the back, destroys both his general, destroys both his wizard, as well as the blue company, because I want to stop those guys from flanking my spearmen there on the right-hand side, and then maybe kind of deal with these skirmishers at another time. So that's what my plan is going on here in the center portion of the lines. And here's a close-up of my Morning Dawn, and I'm just moving up 5 inches so that way they can shoot at whatever target becomes available. I'm thinking that I might be within range of able to shoot at that blue company. If that's the case, I can start pulling those guys down with some long-range repeater crossbow fire. And here's a close-up of my Shacklemore Seers charging into Dawn of the Great Cannon, because that thing needs to die for killing my Charybdis, and plus I'm getting tired of being shot all the time. The goal here is that hopefully my Doomfire Warlocks can either cast a spell or destroy this unit in close combat, and then turn around and then charge directly into the back of the Hellblaster Volleygun and finally put that thing out of commission as well, because I am grasping at straws here and my plan is falling apart, so now I'm just reacting as best I can to the situation as it presents itself to me. During the magic phase, I get four of my dice and decide to cast Arenza Paul's Black Whore. And so I do get that spell off, but as you can see there as well from those four dice located there, I have 2 sixes, and that's why that spell goes off.
Klaatu! Murata!
So as you can see, I managed to kill 13 of those guys as well. I managed to kill about a third of that unit, and I also managed to kill that level 2 wizard that was the Lore of Metalment wizard as well. So that part's kind of nice as well. That part was also kind of nice. So if all things go according to plan, I might be able to kill off his entire magic phase, because I know my general is going to have no problem killing that level 4 life lore mage. So yeah, that was kind of the payoff on that part. However, there was a price to cast that spell. I rolled an 11 on the miscast table. That gave me that power drain ability. And what that did is it dropped down my wizard level all the way down to level 1. I rolled a perfect 3 on a D3. I rolled a 6 on a perfect perfect 6 on a D3. So it dropped her down to three levels. So now Sister Sinner, the Oracle of Cost, is now a level 1 wizard. And the only spell she knows now is Power of Darkness. So that was kind of sad on that part. So I'm kind of depressed about that. All the other spells are gone. I can't count on Shroud of Despair or any other of those other spells to kind of create problems for my opponents. So now it's just down to what I have to win this battle with what I have. Alright, during the shooting phase, I was within range of my Morning Dawn, so I had them cut loose with the repeater crossbows, managed to kill enough 5 more members of that blue company to almost, those guys are almost coming down to about half their size now. There's only about 8 guys in that unit left over now. Unfortunately for me, however, because I don't have long, I have a Shroud of Darkness over them anymore. They get their Inspiring Presence as well as their Hold the Gown rules, so because of that, they just managed to stay put and not go anywhere. They just kind of just hold out and just hold the line at that part. So with shooting over, we go directly to the combat phase. Alright, so this is a photo of the top of turn number 4 after movement phase for the Empire, and the reason why I'm doing this is because I accidentally forgot to take photos of the combat phase from the previous turn for turn number 3 for the Dark Elves, so we're going to explain that really quickly. So you can see here in this picture, what happened was, is with the halberdiers that we were fighting against the yellow company there, against my Dread Spears, got stuck into a challenge my commander did anyways, Captain Lodi Daechir. He got issued a challenge by Archlector Gregor von Draconis, Konas Mark the Grim. I accepted that challenge. The two of them basically fought it out. Archlector managed to put a wound on my Battle Center Bearer, so that part was kind of sad as well. However, I did manage to cut that unit in half in terms of combat between my spearmen as well as my sorceress. My supreme sorceress actually inflicted a wound on there too. So we managed to cut that unit down in half. Unfortunately for me, however, because they have the Griffin Standard at the time, they get an additional bonus from the rank bonuses, so they weren't going to go anywhere either ways. So they just kind of stay put. As you can see, both sides kind of combat reformed to the current position that they're in now. At the same time, when it comes to my Manticore leader, or my general on the Manticore, my Beast Lord, Midas Daechir, he had no problem whatsoever slaughtering that wizard. He just kind of curb stomped that poor guy and killed him. And then I decided to overrun with him to go directly into the flank of the Blue Company there, so that way I can definitely make sure that my guys aren't getting issued here, get hit on the flank on the right hand side for my Dread Spear. So I decided to kind of take them on as well. I didn't show in the next, you don't really see it off screen, but on the picture, but off screen, my Doomfire Warlocks killed Donner, the Great Cannon Magic, kill all the crew members on that part as well. Then they kind of turn to charge into the back of Blitzen as well. So this photo right here is actually after the movie phase for the Empire. As you can see, not much movement really took place, really. The steam tank got stuck because it failed its steam engine check, so it just kind of stays put. Whereas the Queen's Rangers, they kind of turn a little bit 180 to kind of face where my Manticore is, because they're worried that they might have to try to charge my guy into the rear if it gets bogged down in combat against the Blue Company. At the same time, my opponent, King Khalifa, takes his captain on a Pegasus, Hauptmann Hans Jaeger, and Königswinter, and then march flies him from that tower down to just outside those ruins there, so I got to get that guy engaged in close combat as quickly as possible. So that makes it movement, as well as the command phase from last round. So as you can see here in the middle of the page is the close-up of the fight that's taking place between the Yellow Company as well as my Seastone Sorrows. Both unit commanders are kind of engaged in close combat in terms of a challenge, so that's still going on as well. And we're kind of on equal ground in terms of the number of troops that we have left on that unit as well. You can see Panzer Baron, the steam tank on the left-hand side, is still kind of bogged down because he failed his steam engine check. And you also see the Queen's Rangers kind of taking positions to protect the right flank of the Yellow Company. And here's another close-up of Lord Midas Daechir into the right, left-hand flank of the Blue Company as well. And you can also see right on the top, you can see Königswinter as well as Hans Jaeger, Hauptmann Hans Jaeger, kind of moving into to kind of get engaged in that close combat. Worst possible situation is that I get stuck in a three-way charge between being enveloped by the Queen's Rangers in the rear of my character, as well as having the captain on the Pegasus charge into my left flank as well. That would be kind of like a bad situation. That's assuming, of course, I don't just destroy the Blue Company in the process. I'm not really stressing out too much about that part. I have no illusions that my general will be able to destroy that unit, but you know, the way I've been going lately, though, you just don't know. And here's a close-up of my Shacklemore Seers after they destroy the Great Cannon Donner. They just kind of do a quick combat reform facing the back of Blitzen, the Hellblaster Volley Gun. And as you can probably guess, when it comes to my turn, I'm going to charge down directly to that Hellblaster Volley Gun and take out before it's too late. Since there is no magic phase, because all the magic used in the Empire Army is dead, we go directly to the shooting phase, and I forgot that these cannons and artillery pieces can pivot around their center axis, so the Blitzen, the Hellblaster Volley Gun goes 180, decides to open up fire with its cannons, it gets like 16 shots off, and those 16 shots just jelly my Doomfire Warlocks. My Shacklemore Shears get plastered against the side of that hill, and that was the end of that, so I was kind of sad about that part. I forgot that artillery pieces can do this, and that thing just shot my poor guys at point blank range and killed them all, so yeah, that just happened. Alright, during the combat phase, the combat between the Seastone Sorrows as well as the Yellow Company was actually kind of lackluster. I didn't manage to wound the Archelector at all, that Blessed Armor Frederick, that Blessed Armor that he's wearing a meteoric iron. That thing is tough, man. It's got one up armor save plus a 6 up ward save, so that proved to be kind of difficult for me in order to try to wound him on that part. However, he did manage to put a wound on my commander, so that part was kind of sad as well. After that, I also managed to kill a handful of the members of the Yellow Company as well. I killed about 5 of those guys left, and they also managed to kill a couple of my guys as well, so we tend to kind of draw in that combat, so no one's really going anywhere, and so we're just kind of sticking it out now. Combat between the Blue Company as well as my High Beast Lord on Manticore, but just as he expected, Lord Midas Daechir, he managed to destroy that entire army like it was nobody's business on that part. And now what's going to happen now is I have to figure out which one's a greater threat for me now that I defeated the Blue Company. Do I go after the Skirmishers who could like charge into the left of the right-hand flank of my Dread Spears? Do I go after Hauptmann Hans Jaeger as Königswinter in front of me and try to take care of that guy? Or do I go to the Hellblaster Volley Gun? Or do I go to a complete left side of my army, left side of the battlefield, and take on the Steam Tank? And so now I have some kind of decisions to make to figure out which one I think is actually the most dangerous one. Alright, so that takes the bottom turn number 4 for the Dark Elves after the movement phase. And as you can see in this photo, I decided that the steam tank was actually more of a threat for me to deal with. So what I did is I charged Lord Midas Daechir from across the other side of the battlefield over the opposing units and have him slam right in front of the steam tank and kind of take him on in close combat as well. The reason why is because I'm going to try to use my crossman to try to take out Königswinter as well as Hans Jaeger, try to get rid of that guy as well. And the hope is because those skirmishers are kind of the way, the Hellblaster Volley Gun won't be able to engage my Manticore after I kill the steam tank, and that can move on from there. All right, that takes us directly to the shooting phase. And during the shooting phase, my Morning Dawn takes aim with the repeater crossbows. They open up on Hauptmann Hans Jaeger as well as Conewinder and manage to blast that guy out of existence. He blew that dude away, so that part was actually kind of cool. So Chuck went down for the Pegasus Knight. With shooting over with, they go directly into the combat phase. And as you can see in this picture, I had no problem whatsoever killing off the Panzer Baron with my general. With the Chill Blade, I managed to put on 3 wounds on top of that, with the additional 4 attacks I rolled up for his Blind Rage Fury, Blind Rage ability. For my Manticore, that was able to destroy the remaining wounds that were left over on the steam tank as well. Also, if you look in the picture as well, between the combat between my Morning, my Seastone Sorrows, as well as the Yellow Company, they managed to kill a couple more of my Dread Spears at the same time, managed to kill another couple more of the Halberdiers as well. Also managed to put a wound onto the Archlector, so that pretty much makes it the combat phase on this one. With the combat phase finished, that takes us directly to the top of turn number 5 for the Empire. Not much movement actually took place during the Empire movement phase. All he really did is he took his Queen's Rangers, had them move on the back trail of the Yellow Company in order to try to engage my Manticore, my Beastlord Manticore. And since his wizard died, we went directly to the shooting phase. And during the shooting phase, he took Blitzen, the Hellblaster Volley Gun, and went to go fire the roll number of shots he got for his Hellblaster Volley Gun against my Manticore. And he rolled 3 misfires.
This is my boomstick!
For those of you who are unaware of how Hellblaster Volley Gun rules basically work, what happens when you roll your artillery dice, you take 3 artillery dice, you roll them to figure out how many shots your Hellblaster Volley Gun actually fires. If you roll a single misfire die, what happens is that half your shots are all you can really get off during the shooting phase. If you roll 2 misfires, I believe you can't fire that turn, you gotta roll on the misfire chart. However, if you get 3 misfires in a row, what happens is that your Hellblaster Volley Gun opens up with all 30 shots on your interior target, which means that this thing fires 30 shots at my Manticore, and at the same time it goes out of action as well, because pretty much it blows up. As you can see from this photo, the Manticore basically died. There's nothing really more to say about it. All those 30 shots opened up. I think he wounded my Manticore, my general, something like around the realm of 16 times or something ridiculous like that. So needless to say, my general and his Manticore are now dead. They are turned to hamburger meat, and this is just getting worse for me every single time, man. That Hellblaster Volley Gun is deadly. And to make matters worse, during the combat phase, as you can see in this photo, the Yellow Company managed to kill the remainder of what basically was left behind of my unit. I managed to kill their general, which was kind of nice. So Archlector Konigsmark is dead between the combat between my captain as well as his Archlector. However, between the remaining attacks of his halberdiers as well as his captain, it just ended up destroying what was left over of my army of that unit. It was absolutely just horrible. I just rolled poorly for all my saves as well as my ward saves, and it was just totally inexcusable at that point. So yeah, things are looking up for me now. Okay, so that takes us directly to top number turn of 5 for the Dark Elves after movement phase. As you can see in this photo, all I really did is I moved up my Morning Dawn as quick as they possibly could. I just moved up 5 inches between that space between the two fours, and during my shooting phase, I had them cut loose and destroyed the remainder of the Yellow Company. Managed to kill his captain as well as the rest of his halberdiers for that unit, and because I really can't do anything else, that pretty much makes up my entire turn. Alright, and as you can see here, that pretty much brings us to the end of the game, and the reason why we went to the end of the game is because, unfortunately, both King Cleef and I thought we thought that turn number 5 was turn number 6 at the time that we played it, so because of that, we kind of ended the game at that point. So you can see here, all our armies are pretty much destroyed. The only thing we have left are the Queen's Rangers for the Empire, as well as my Morning Dar for the Dark Elves, and we didn't learn until later on, actually, until we were starting to do the battle report when I was working on it, that I realized that we actually short ourselves another turn. But in all fairness, though, I don't know what would have happened if we win another turn or not. So yeah, that pretty much brings us to the end of the game for this one. With that being said, we go on to the after action report.
Sure, I could have stayed in the past, could have even been king, but in my own way I am king. Hail to the king, baby.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, now it's time for the After Action Report. This is the part of the show we talk about what went well, what went poorly, what we can do for the next time that we do battle. This is the After Action Report for Battle Report number 23. Ended up being a victory for yours truly. So let's go ahead and talk about why that is the case. First of all, I lost Beast Lord, Midas Laynell, the Golden Lord of Skyros, Sister Sinner, the Oracle of Kos, Captain Lodi Daechir, the Golden Sun, the Sea Stone Stars, the Storms of Kos, Virus of the Broken, the Shacklemore Seers, and Rathric the Maw, and that brings up my losses up to 2,036 points on that part. All right, so let's go talk about the losses for my buddy King Khalifa. He lost Archelector Gregor von Konigsmark the Grim. He also lost Victor Helsbert of the Wilds, Hauptmann Dieter Munz the Griffin Guard, Hauptmann Hans Jaeger and Königswinter. He also lost his wizard Maximilian the Max, the Yellow Company, the Red Company, the Blue Company, Rommel's Rangers, Donner Blitzen, as well as the Panzer Baron. That brings up his grand total to 2,388 points, so that makes me the victor on this part. To be honest, this game was extremely close. We only had one unit apiece by the end of the battle. It was actually one of the most violent battles ever been used for in this battle. So let's go and talk about some of the things that kind of caused this to take place. First of all, I totally misused my Doomfire Warlocks. I forgot to use the Vanguard rules and get those guys to kind of move up forward, and because that was all my fault. By the time my turn came around, they're already halfway affected because most of the guys have been killed by long-range fire from that Hellblaster Volley Gun. Same thing with destroying the Steam Tank earlier. I should have engaged it earlier with my units. The Beast Lord, Midas, Daechir, and Calibos had the Chill Blade, and they would have destroyed that thing in a couple of rounds of combat, and then I don't have to worry about it, killing Wrathric the Maw and causing all kinds of problems for me as well. Also in this battle, I found out that I was kind of too spread out as always. I need to stick more with the whole rank and flank style of tactics, or basically I kind of keep together, engage with my suppression units, and then of course flank with my assaulting units to kind of take them out as well. Another thing though is my buddy King Khalifa, man, he took this army list and he knows how to use it. He kind of like as like at the master's level of how to use this army list. He made excellent use of his skirmishers as well as his redirectors and just kind of played merry hot with me the entire time and was just kind of like kicking my butt the entire time with this combat as well. The artillery for this arm is extremely powerful as well. The great cannon as well as combined with the great cannon from the steam tank are very, very deadly. And same thing with the Hellblaster Volley Gun, I think is really bad as well. I need to get those engaged sooner to avoid the firepower for the next time. In order to do that, I might do a couple things. One of the things I might want to do is redistribute my points in my army and, you know, try to get me to get new units, or I go to the 2,500 point mark and do it that way. Either way, good for me. Either way, so I'm kind of, you know, I'm getting used to playing with 2,000 points now. It's starting to get a little boring for me, so I want to try to amp it up and go to 2,500 points like I used to back in the day. Once again, this was an excellent game. This was a great opponent. I'm looking forward to doing it again because, man, my buddy King Khalifa is getting deadly with this list, and I need to be able to fight him on the next one. Once again, feel free to go to my Instagram account. I have a link on my banner on my page as well as the description below in my account, so that way you can take a look at that. My Instagram account is called Cheapskate Commander, and you can stay up to date with all my hobby work, with terrain, with miniatures that we're painting, and all that kind of jazz. We also got some sneak peeks and some things we're working on for future programming and content for my channel, so you can take a look at that and see how that looks. As always, please feel free to like.